those of you who are not related to me, my name is Will McLean. And I would like to introduce you to the architect, Adam Kalkin, whom I was fortunate enough to meet here in this building 22 years ago. And it has to be said, I was even more fortunate to meet Sam, my beautiful wife, happy birthday, at the same time. To go to architecture school then was incredibly exciting. Suddenly I was in an environment where you could completely immerse yourself in the idea of architecture and what that might mean, and make drawings and make other stuff. And I do hope that this school allows for that possibility, where ideas still allows for it, where ideas are explored and tested in a highly critical but not miserablest or po-faced way. I'm sorry I'm reading this. It sounds like a wedding speech. okay. A bit worse. Sorry, okay. Don't stop booing. I was booed once when I did a best man speech. Okay, this school has also allowed you to meet people from allowed you to meet people from different places with entirely different approaches to the subject. We met Adam early on and became good friends. And I was equally perplexed or intrigued by the way he thought and worked, always with a huge amount of what I can only describe as North American largesse. I couldn't say magnanimity. I could say anyway. And straight ahead. Keep moving. Keep thinking. Keep asking questions. Keep doing. And he has certainly kept doing. In his own opinion, he has made a small amount of projects with a high attrition rate. I would suggest that by European comparisons, he's been incredibly successful in getting some seriously good projects built and continues to, to do so. He has recently announced to me that he's giving up architecture. Well, I hope he isn't. Because despite what you hear from the RIBA, AIA, architecture schools and what have you, there are actually very few good architects, or ones we know about. Anyway, tonight Adam is going to speak, or possibly perform, and afterwards we are going to officially launch the book, this book, I should have, I haven't got the book, which is called Quik Build, Adam Kalkin's ABC of Container Architecture. My God, this is the longest introduction I've ever given in my life. Right. The first publication from Bibliothèque McLean, something I've been involved in, which is a kind of record of the shipping container works of Adam Kalkin, which was obviously a pleasure to work on. And there will be a signing afterwards, and there will be drinks, so if you're desperate this time of evening, which I am, they're just in there. The magic door will be opened afterwards. So I'd like to thank Belinda for organising this. I'd like to thank Charlotte Newman of the newly reopened bookshop, which is very good, and they're having their opening official thing tonight, who's kindly overseeing sales of the book, which is on a special deal this evening. As Gordon Brown might say, let's start some fiscal stimulus this evening, or something like that, baby. I would also like to note that this book is beautifully designed by Mark Boyce, who's here in the audience this evening. So thank you, Mark. And beautifully printed by Lecturus of Eindhoven, and Rick Leuven from Lecturus is also here this evening. So thank you very much. And I think that's it. So Adam, thank you very much.
Thank you. I've been interested lately in music, so I thought I'd begin with a performance of Adam Kalkin's 433.
Thank you. just stand there. Haven't you anything to say?
Batai said that architecture can only really be a model of itself, and I find that particular clip from The Ladies' Man, which is a film by Jerry Lewis in the 60s, to be almost a perfect representation of what I think architecture is and the conflation between performance and a model and music. And this project, which I'm showing you right now, is, I think, very much related to that piece. It's a. This is a house called Bunny Lane, which is there was. You can see that there's an old cottage in the middle of an aircraft hangar. The cottage was there. The cottage is about 120 years old, and I put an aircraft hangar around it and made. I don't know, something like a soundstage in that last. There are large doors that open up. You can see on either side. I think this building is really sort of a conflation of different buildings, and so there's some kind of a modern concrete building in the back, and then there's some kind of a indoor-outdoor space in the middle. But I realize how important Jerry Lewis is to the history of architecture. This is a piece called Adam Kalkin Day Trader, which I did a couple of years ago. And it has to do, I think, with pretty much everything that's written on the board there. I mean, it has to do with the flow of capital and the relationship between creative endeavors and kind of following a trajectory from an initial experience into many other ones that follow that are very different from it. It's true that even the most strenuous and dangerous play is by definition not work. It does not produce any commodities. Where it does, it goes professional. But this fact from the start makes the comparison of adult and child's play somewhat senseless, for the adult is a commodity producing and commodity exchanging being, whereas the child is only preparing to become one. And I think that as architects, we're pretty much right at the fulcrum of that. Believing that America is a machine designed for the efficient allocation of capital, and further that it is its citizens' obligation to energetically exploit any pricing inconsistencies in its broad and deep capital markets, Adam Kalkin borrowed $1 million to day trade in the stock market. Chapter 1, securing a capital stake by incurring debt. Adam Kalkin borrowed $1 million from the U.S. Trust Company. Chapter 2, risk assumption and profit generation. I began to day trade on in February 2005. This is a summary of all the trades I made over the course of about 3 months, 2 or 3 months. There were about 1,000 different trades. In June, I repaid the $1 million plus $12,000 in interest that I incurred over the 3 months, and I generated a net profit of $51,000, which was recycled into the economy in the following manner. I donated $10,000 to a Tanzanian orphanage. I put $37,000 into the manufacture of a push-button house. I left $1,000 in a paper bag on a New York City bus, and I put $1,200 into the reverse Jerry Lewis auction, whereby I offered for people to change their name to Jerry Lewis until I finally started at $500, increased in $100 increments until finally at $1,200 I got someone to change their name to Jerry Lewis. Here is the push-button house. This was a sketch of it. It operates with a sort of a complicated hydraulic system, which is programmed by CPU, which is located in the kitchen island. Again, I think you see the influence of Ladies' Man in here. I made that piece with the $32,000, and then Adam Kalkin day trader continued when Illy Coffee bought that piece for significantly in excess of that number. And there was further profit generated by that. Here's the piece. I redid it. I actually redid it for Illy. And this is the piece at the Venice Biennale a couple of years ago. It reminds me of Dan Flavin, who, you know, made his pieces out of fluorescent lights. And one of the points that he was trying to make was that, you know, you can make art out of the most, you know, uncelebrated things and out of exchangeable pieces that you can buy in the hardware store. In other words, something that's totally everyday. And of course, what happened to Flavin's pieces as they've sort of fallen apart and those things are no longer made, there's a whole army of technicians now that recreate all the things that were in the fluorescent tube fixtures at the time that he manufactured them. So no artist is greater than the systems that absorb them. And everything you make, no matter what, will become a fetish object. In fact, the greater it is, probably the more fetishized it gets. Illy then asked me to do a second piece, so this is another push-button house. This is a push-button house, two. This is it in the Time Warner Center in New York City. Instead of using computer-controlled hydraulics, I used the very refined set of mechanical screw actuators. The loads were actually much greater in this piece. And you can see how this one works. Here's it in action. Lately, I've been redrawing some of the Dr. Seuss, iconic Dr. Seuss works. Which are obviously all about domestic space and how that's seen through the eyes of children. Same way that Cage's piece is an appropriation of ambient sound. There's a lot of appropriation and sampling in my work, especially the container, which is obviously a sampled, commodified object. But what you can do with it, I think, is limitless. And this, the Quik House, is the piece that is the central piece of the container book, Quik Build, that we're talking about. And this is a totally commodified object made out of six containers, which are put together. And I tried to create the perfect house with three bedrooms and 2.5 baths designed for a small family. Because architecture, I think, ultimately does want to be a commodified object. It's just, there are a lot of hurdles to it really getting there. I offer this in several different facade versions with foldable windows, garage doors, different variations and permutations on the theme. Different floor plans. Different roofs. You can have the turf roof, you can have a roof deck, a plain roof, a roof deck with a solar screen. And here is a sketch of an idealized Quik House. And from the back. This is the reality of making one. Here's one in the factory. Sometimes ideas do matter. There was such an interest in this from a show that I did in New York a few years ago that I felt obliged to actually open a factory to actually make these things. Here they are, kind of worked over before they get shipped out. Here's an on-site assembly of one of the Quik Houses. This is actually a combination of a Quik House and an old lady house. The one in the front is slab on grade. Everything's brought to the site and craned into place. We put these two buildings together in about 4 hours. But again, the theater, architecture can never get away from the performative formative aspects, not only of its construction, but also of its habitation. These are the basic shells completed. Glazing. In this case, there's a bridge that connects the two houses. This is a piece at the Shelburne Museum in Vermont, made out of, this is a hybrid piece also related to the Quik House series, made out of a combination of a butler building, you know, warehouse, prefabricated system, and containers as well. There's a big fabric outdoor space, you can see. is the male end of the house. All these objects in here are collections from the museum, so you can see how it serves the purpose there. This is another piece that's in Maine. This house was made out of 12 containers. And it's a bigger house. It's about 4,000 square feet, right on the bay. It's just two sets of six containers which kind of buttress each other and then are covered again by a prefabricated roofing system made by the Butler Company. So it's really an assembly, a kit of parts. There's nothing that can't be domesticated. These are standardized cornier curtain wall system. This is a project where we began to use the containers to put them into a more complex system which can create villages. In this case, refugee villages, where people can build their own. In the aftermath of a disaster or a displaced population, can actually, they're simple enough that the population themselves can build their own village. This is the basic unit of four, you know, Quik House variations which surround a courtyard. So agriculture is built into this, trying to build in sustaining food systems as well as sustaining architectural systems. And here is the village layout with a central street. In this case, this was designed for Afghanistan. So there's kind of a commercial street in the center, and the living quarters are mostly on the second floor. Little animal husbandry. Here's a piece I was very interested in. Duchamp's Boite. So I made a museum which the viewers carried supine on a conveyor belt through the museum. You can see. So there, the curator can program the speed of the conveyor belt. And there are about 100 pieces of my own in this 20-foot container. So you see, let me do the math quickly, you see about a piece every half a second. Entering the museum. I have an obsession with clowns. This is a piece that I was just about to start to build for Yahoo until Microsoft started to try to buy them. So one of the things that I've been talking about the last few days is how there are so many things outside of the architect's control that you could never anticipate, that just, whether it's, could be anything that can, so things, the stars are aligned for the creation of architecture for only a very short period of time, and you really need to strike while the iron's hot. This piece, hydraulically, through the use of hydraulic lifts and airbags that get actuated as the truck turns itself over. And Microsoft didn't even end up buying Yahoo, so. So this is a traveling Yahoo retail space. And the airbags reinflate. And the truck rights itself and goes off to the next destination. and one of the greatest appropriations in the music world. Paul Anka redoes that wonderful song.
Load up my guns and bring your friends. It's fun to lose and to pretend. She's overboard, she's self-assured. Oh no, I know a dirty word. Hello, 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 how low. Hello, 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 how low. With the lights out, less dangerous. Here we are now, entertain us. I feel stupid, contagious. Here we are now, entertain us. I'm a lotto, an albino, a mosquito, my libido. Yeah. I'm worse at what I do best, and for this gift I do feel blessed. And our little group has always been and always will until the end. Hello, 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 how low.
I think I'll finish with the third movement of Adam Kalkin 433. Thank you very much.